In her fourth State of the State speech since taking office, Governor Susana Martinez touted what she said were the top accomplishments by her administration and the legislature, by the way, including tax reform, fixing unemployment insurance, and balancing the budget. But she said there was more work to be done and urged lawmakers to, quote, choose reform over the status quo, end quote. Her Democratic rivals for governor, as well as Senate Democrats, were quick to respond, saying her efforts did not go far enough to address poverty and job creation. And joining us to discuss the speech and reactions to it are several new faces at the line table. Very excited about some of these, including former State Representative Janice Arnold-Jones. She's here for the first time at our table. Another line newbie is here, and that would be Inez Russell Gomez, editorial page editor at the Santa Fe New Mexican. Former State Senator Eric Griego joins us for the first time at the table this week, and grizzled line veteran Russell Contreras is going to teach them all how this works. He's from the Associated Press. We'll be showing several clips from the governor's speech and talking about them, so let's get started with this section on creating technology jobs here in New Mexico.
Starting a business, creating jobs, it involves risk. And successful economies embrace new ideas, encourage risk takers. New Mexico should be a technology jobs leader, a haven for innovation, a place where the best and the brightest come to bring their products to the market. And here's how I propose to do that. To increase the pipeline of innovation, $7.5 million to help our universities attract the best professors and researchers in the world. $2 million so universities and labs can take their groundbreaking projects to the marketplace. Expand the angel investment credit to help startups get the capital they need to get off the ground. And provide greater incentives for every new technology job created here in New Mexico. This plan will help make New Mexico a technology jobs leader.
Eric, I want to start with you on that clip. I was interested to hear the governor talk about risk taking. Interesting to hear our leaders talking about this. You don't hear that enough here in New Mexico, it seems to me, sometimes. But do her goals, as you heard them outlined, is that appealing to risk takers? Will risk takers take a bite and say, all right, New Mexico, that's where it's happening right now? What's your thought on that?
Well, I have to say I was encouraged to say that at least there was some emphasis on this idea of innovation and entrepreneurship, which I think is often neglected. I mean, it's paid lip service too, but really most of the jobs, as we always say, are small business and, you know, kind of the talent that we have here. So I'm encouraged. I think I'm a little fuzzy on how it's going to play out, what kind of professorships we're talking about. And whether or not we have the cultural will at the labs and other places to really sort of spin out this technology, or at the university, frankly. So, but I like that we're not just talking about how do we land the next big fish, that we're talking about leveraging what we have here, the entrepreneurs, the talent we have here.
That's a good point, Janice. I mean, Eric's making a point there, that we're not just throwing a big net out for the big fish, the big corporations and all that kind of thing. There's an acknowledgement that technology at its seed point is important for us. Did you get that same sense as well?
Well, I have to say, finally.
Right?
Finally. Our record of enticing big businesses to come and create jobs, it doesn't work that way. We have intrinsic value in our state, and we have failed to actually provide that to the marketplace. Now, I do have some problems in that I appreciate spending $7.5 million on new professors, but the truth is, the issue that holds us back is time and distance. And I believe that I wish the governor would address this, is when our agencies hold up an entrepreneur for 6 months or 2.5 years before they can get going, their money's gone and they're gone.
That's a good point.
And I really wanted to hear that part.
And Russell, good to see you again, by the way. And this idea of $2 million also for to take projects to market, I'm a little confused how that actually works, because when you take something to market, the market is writing the check to bring, you know what I mean? You're offering, there's a trade here. I'm not quite sure where the state steps in to help people bring stuff to market. Did you have a sense of what that actually meant?
Yeah, that was unclear. That was unclear, and also, how are you going to attract these professors here?
Right.
Because right now, New Mexico would be competing with universities in Silicon Valley. You would be competing with universities in Texas and Austin. You're competing with the technology centers in Massachusetts. So what is going to be done to separate New Mexico to say, hey, professor, come here? This is coming at a time where Intel, by all accounts, may be leaving. We're seeing them hiring more folks in Israel. They're cutting jobs. Are they going to stay in Rio Rancho? That is sort of the elephant in the room. Are they going to stay? And if they do, what happens to Rio Rancho?
Sure.
That, and also with cuts in government spending, how is that affecting the labs? So if I'm a professor, I'm looking for innovation. I want to bring my best graduate students to whatever university I'm taking. These are unanswered questions. Is this a place that I want to bring my scholarship? Mm-hmm. You know, that's unclear.
Mm-hmm. I like that. Is this a place I want to bring my scholarship? That's actually a really good question. Santa Fe, of course, is no small place for innovation. Innovation is practically the middle name there. You know, and again, there's a lot of benefit, it seems to me, for a smaller community footprint like Santa Fe to have a boost like this. Is there a sense that that could be possible for Santa Fe as you look at it as well?
It could be. Of course, the research professors and all those people are at the big universities, the University of New Mexico and New Mexico State. Mm-hmm. However, bringing smart people who are going to do research projects could benefit Santa Fe because we have the lab right there. We have the Santa Fe Institute. We have a lot of science that people aren't necessarily aware of taking place. Mm-hmm. And you have to think back to the history of New Mexico. What if we'd had a loan program that would have kept Bill Gates and Microsoft in Albuquerque? Right.
Ouch. Yeah.
But just on Russell's point about mm-hmm. Intel, you know, that's a great, the status quo, there's a lot of conversation about new versus status quo. The status quo economic development model has been land the big fish, mm-hmm. you know, incentivize them. There's even money in this new jobs proposal that the Jobs Council or whatever put together. Mm-hmm. I mean, there are no guarantees that no matter what we throw at some of these big companies, they're going to come or they're going to stay. So building it from the ground up, mm-hmm. supporting local entrepreneurs, I think that's the approach. I also agree that I'm not sure. The biggest thing I hear from small businesses and innovators is access to capital, access to capital, access to capital. So if some of this is for that, hallelujah.
Mm-hmm. I agree. Some of the newer entrepreneurs especially, access to capital is everything. Now, Governor Martinez noted that while she did not support Obamacare, expanding Medicaid was the right thing to do for New Mexico, as she mentioned. And that means creating more jobs in healthcare to meet that demand, including training more nurses. Here's the next clip.
I'm also proposing aggressive initiatives to increase the number of primary care providers of all types all over New Mexico. We'll help repay student loans, doubling our commitment, particularly for those who agree to serve in rural areas. This will create up to 720 new healthcare workers this decade. Nurses, dentists, physicians, and others in areas that are too often underserved. Expand telemedicine, connecting rural area providers and patients with a physician or a specialist. Train more doctors and nurse practitioners here at home.
Russell, on that question, interesting feedback I got in an email this week from a man who's been in the business of recruiting doctors for New Mexico for 30 years. His position was the difficulty is in the doctor's spouses, meaning their wives, who are usually highly accomplished women on their own doing lots of great things, but they don't want to move to a rural place where the schools are not great and, you know, there's not a big peer group. And I'm not sure what one can do about that, actually, but is the governor on the right track to try to stem some of that and just really try to get this moving again?
Well, she's got to do something because there is a shortage of, as she mentioned, nurse practitioners, doctors, health professions. This is an area of the economy that's actually growing across the country.
Right.
Because not only of healthcare spending, but because we got a lot of baby boomers who are aging. Mm-hmm. And they need access to various health, various care. Mm-hmm. So there is a shortage and there is a need. So it is just that she goes this way. The idea that a spouse or a family may not want to move in the rural area because of our schools. This is another addressed, a long-standing issue with us. When you look at the school results of 2 years ago, in 2011, 2012, three districts out of all our districts made IYP, adequate year of progress.
Wow.
So that is telling. I mean, when you have 80% of the schools not making it, 70 to 80%, and you have a family wants to relocate their family from, say, Colorado or Massachusetts mm-hmm. or New York to come to New Mexico, take that chance, take that risk, what are you providing them? Mm-hmm. And this is, I don't see anything right now, any proposals that address that one standing issue. I see a lot of incremental stuff, but that needs to be addressed.
I've heard similar, Inez, from what Russell's saying here, because it's not always about money and getting your loans paid off. It's about the quality of your individual life. And so those other issues have to be addressed as well. It has to be a multi-pronged approach, it would seem to me.
It is. I think that in medicine, that's one of the best ways to grow your own, though.
Ah.
Because you get people, let's say, from a small town like Cuesta, you take them, they go to UNM, you help them get to medical school, they might go home.
Mm-hmm.
When I was editor of the Taos News in my previous career, I met a doctor who was paying off her student loan. She was stuck in Taos. Well, I look at the paper, she's still there, and that's, you know, 15 years later.
Wow.
So I think that if we focus on training people who have ties to the community, who have roots, they're going to go home. And at the same time, as we recruit people from out of state, a lot of, luckily, doctors are in two doctor families. So they both can get jobs. That's right. The case at St. Vincent's. You have a lot of spouses working there or in Santa Fe. Mm-hmm. And you also have to look at maybe the schools are not standardized testing the way you want them to according to the mm-hmm. supposed standards that are working. But you have a lot of other issues in the schools where you're going to get to know all kinds of people. You're going to get to go to school with Native kids, sure. with Hispanic kids. And you're going to get a diversity of experience that you're not going to get if you stay, let's say, in Ohio or Illinois or one of those other states.
I appreciate you saying that. That's the sell to me. That's a quality of life issue. Yes. I really appreciate. Now, I seem to remember you used to worked on this in your time in the legislature, this idea of nurse practitioners especially, more nurse practitioners in our state.
Well, I'm saying, so I want to talk about quality of life.
Please.
But the most exciting thing that the governor said to in this speech mm-hmm. was reciprocity. To say that nurse practitioners can come to this state and within 5 days can practice, that is huge. Mm-hmm. And as I look at many of the bureaucratic things that are actually keeping entrepreneurs from succeeding, this is the one step that mm-hmm. I was really encouraged about. But it is time for us to talk about quality of life. If we think that mm-hmm. doctors and families that have two physicians in them aren't interested in the quality of life of living in a small community where you know your neighbors, believe it or not, those doctors exist. It's time that we sell not only our diversity, which I thought was a good piece in her speech, yeah. but also the fact that we have a unique quality of life. We're not compact. We have room to breathe. We have vistas that nobody else has. Mm-hmm. Why aren't we selling that?
I have a friend. He's a doctor in the Midwest. He's a distance bike rider. It would be his dream to live in New Mexico, yes. Eric Riego, and practice and also live his personal life here. He came to visit me once. He did the crazy 60-mile loop in the East Mountains, just like he was waking up out of bed. He loves New Mexico. He would never come here to work. Never come here to work,
and did
unfortunately,
he tell you
because
why?
The pay would, in his specialty, in his practice, the pay wouldn't be there.
You know? I think, I mean, I also, you know, we also sure. know lots of docs, and, you know, depending on where they are in the career, if they're not yet having a family, if they're earlier in the career, mm-hmm. when those loans are really starting to sort of impact, I think that, you know, there mm-hmm. are things, and I'm not opposed to the idea of, you know, how can we make it easier for them at least at the beginning of their career before they're more established, because mm-hmm. ultimately we're not going to be able to afford in some of these smaller communities the kind of salaries that specialists expect. Mm-hmm. I think the bigger issue is that, you know, with the healthcare reform and increased access, mm-hmm. Delivering those services, not just in the small community, but frankly right here in Albuquerque, in the biggest city,
sure.
we do not have a coherent strategy for how you're actually going to get the care. It's great that we're all going to have, in theory, the ability to do it, but mm-hmm. you know, for those of us who do have health insurance, you know, a pediatric ophthalmologist, mm-hmm. you know, there's just only a couple in town, you know, my little guy, it's like waiting on Guffman to get That's to right. actually get to see a doc, you know,
right.
So we have to address this head on, and you know, if this helps, you know, I'm open to it. I'm underwhelmed by the 720 jobs created by the end of the year. I mean, in an economy this size, but sure. you know, let's we have to do something.
Sure.
Please. Well, I would say, but exactly where I was going, mm-hmm. 720 jobs this decade. That gives us 6 years. It's about 150 jobs a year. But we have 205,000 new individuals that will be seeking care.
Right.
And I am just looking at the numbers, and
the math doesn't add up, as they say.
No, it doesn't.
Yeah, interesting. The governor also cast the idea of investing in water infrastructure as a way to foster economic development here in New Mexico. Here's a quick summary of that plan.
Building and repairing our water infrastructure has never been more important. Everyone agrees on that. That's why I'm asking that we invest 60% of our capital dollars on critical water projects throughout New Mexico. These capital dollars are not my dollars or the legislature's dollars. These tax dollars belong to the people of New Mexico, and they should be invested where they need help the most. And water projects should be on the top of that list.
Janice Arnold-Jones, a very obvious and quick question. Individual legislators to give up their capital outlay money is always a tough push. What do you think of the chances here when you're talking 60% going to water?
Well, you know, I think everybody gets it. They mm-hmm. understand that we need to do the big projects. It's very tough to do that. However, I need some specifics. Mm-hmm. You know, are we talking sewer? Are we talking pipelines? You know, we have been working on water projects across the state. We have 16 regional plans that all need to be updated. Mm-hmm. Are we talking about leadership from the Interstate Stream Commission? I'm going, yes, yes. Are we talking sewers? I love to talk about sewers, but I didn't know what it was. And to get the legislators to give up their capital, you better tell me what it's for.
Yeah, interesting. You'd agree with that?
I think it's kind of DOA, to be perfectly honest. First of all, we take 10% off the top already for water projects that go into a fund.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Behind the politics are such that this will heavily skew toward rural areas, areas that obviously the governor has a lot more support in and so on. So I think, these are not frivolous projects. Legislators want to fund senior centers, they want to fund roads, they want to fund a lot of things. So, and some of them will fund water projects, but mm-hmm. I think 60% off the top, I think it's in theory it's a good
idea. Sure. How did that hit you when you heard 60%? Was there an immediate gut reaction for you on that?
Definitely. I actually sent an email to the governor's office and said, can I have a list? What are they? And they referred me to the Environment Department. I'm getting a list, so I will know at least some of them, mm-hmm. I hope soon, because I couldn't figure out what she was talking about, and I wanted to know.
Right. I don't think there would be much disagreement, Russell Contreras, that, as she says, water projects should be on the top of the list. Nobody would disagree with that. It's a question of how at this point. But what if it turns out 60% isn't enough to solve our problems?
Right.
We're still in an extreme drought.
Yep.
And, with a dry January with no idea of rain or moist until maybe this week, we're still facing crisis situation. And it's interesting that as California faces a drought now it's become a national issue.
Right.
It's been in New Mexico for years. Now California is getting mm-hmm. some of this wrath, and now it's a big thing.
Yep.
So there's still some details to be worked out. And it's a difference a decade makes, because 10 years ago, all the capital outlay money was going to improve schools. Remember that?
Yep.
And we needed to improve schools, and now it's water. Mm-hmm. Where are those issues? Where are they going? And will this have any effect on drought?
Yeah. I can't wait to see your list when you get it. I mean, this is a good point Janice makes, too. It's like, where is this stuff going? Now, in a moment, we're back with Environment Secretary-Designate Ryan Flynn.